For effectively my entire childhood, I was obsessed with the end of the world. I watched all the great disaster movies of the mid-2000s and the endless supply of zombie media. I read every age-appropriate post-apocalyptic book I could get my hands on, and also all of the age-inappropriate ones. Like, I read The Stand when I was 12, and it was literally traumatizing. I also read the entire Children's Left Behind series, checked it out book by book every week from my church library. I even loved just imagining the end of the world and playing pretend in it. I went out into the woods and pretended to forage for survival. I gathered acorns and imagined bartering them for produce harvested by other primitive post-civilization people. Anytime we lost power or had a tornado warning, I was actually excited. I got a genuine thrill out of deciding which blankets and toys I would want to have with me if my world ended. For a while, when people asked me what I wanted to be when I grew up, I told them I wanted to be an eschatologist, a scholar of end times. Honestly, I kind of wanted the world to end. Looking back on this with a few years of therapy under my belt, it's obvious that this obsession came from a lot of pent-up anxiety. I mean, I was kind of an anxious mess as a kid. But in my defense, it's not like this fixation happened in a void. I consumed that media because that was the media that was being made and advertised in the 2000s and early 2010s. To put it in perspective, in the space of just 6 years, we saw the release of The Day After Tomorrow, Shaun of the Dead, The Dawn of the Dead remake, The War of the Worlds remake, the final four books in the Left Behind Kids series, the entire Hunger Games trilogy, the book and subsequent film adaptations of The Road and World War Z, both seasons of Jericho, Children of Men, I Am Legend, The Day the Earth Stood Still, 2012, Fallout 3 and Fallout New Vegas, Zombieland, The Book of Eli, and the first season of The Walking Dead. These were also the prime years for conservative talk show hosts telling us that a violent takeover of the US and later Obamageddon were on the horizon, and our only way to survive the coming end times was to buy their commemorative gold coins and buckets of seeds. On the other side, we had An Inconvenient Truth, which premiered in 2006 and paved the way for more documentaries and PSAs warning us of the dangers of global warming and how our planet's on the brink of destruction. How could you not be filled with existential anxiety during these years? And the worst part is, while disaster movies may no longer be in vogue, we still have this feeling that things are reaching a fever pitch. Many of us still have apocalyptic anxieties. Clearly, it's not just me, but the entire American culture that's obsessed with the end of the world. Apocalyptic thinking is almost a part of our identity now. In fact, with how much we think about it and talk about it and examine it in our art, it's almost like we actively want the world to end. But why? Well, let's explore the end of the world together. It's going to be a heavy one. We're going to talk about a lot of big themes and uncomfortable topics like violence, weapons, racism, colonialism, disasters, including 9/11 and Hurricane Katrina, death, existentialism, and, you know, the end of the world. But this video isn't going to be a total downer, and it's also not going to be a misanthropic, everything would be better if people just stopped existing thing. It's going to be an investigation of why we're obsessed with the end of the world and what that obsession says about us. And it's also going to be full of hope. Because here at what feels like the end of all things, hope is a very important thing to have. But before we jump in, I want to give a quick shout out to the Human Restoration Project, who very kindly sponsored this video. The Human Restoration Project is a 501c3 educational nonprofit that strives to bring the humanity back into education. I've talked about them a couple times on this channel because I genuinely love and admire how they fight for progressive liberatory education through practical, hands-on grassroots efforts. Well, they have a virtual conference coming up, their second annual Conference to Restore Humanity. And this year's theme is Breaking the Doom Loop.
I just totally, completely forgot to mention the dates, but that is from July 24th through the 27th.
They have a great lineup of speakers and Q&As and workshops all about how we can break the spell of doomerism, find hope for the future, and then use that hope as a platform to make real change. This conference is great for both K-12 and college educators, and honestly, just for anyone who's even just like interested in education. And they have worked really hard to make sure that the entire conference is sustainable, accessible, affordable, and collaborative. They asked me to extend an invitation to my audience because I know that a lot of you are education nerds who are really into this kind of stuff. And what's even better is if you use the code ZOEB, you'll get $25 off your registration price, and I will also get a direct kickback for each registration that uses my code. So if you want to both save money yourself and help to directly support my work, then be sure to use code ZOEB, that is ZOEBEE, all one word, when you register. I also have links in the description to the conference FAQ, or if you just want to check out their website on your own, they recently added a bunch of new educational resources to their site, so even if the conference isn't your thing, they are definitely still worth checking out. Anyway, I could rave about HRP forever, but for now, let's jump into the apocalypse, shall we? To allow ourselves to be seduced by the story of apocalypse is like clutching the railing of a sinking ship. The solid feel of the familiar wood and metal may make you feel more secure, but to survive, you have to get off the ship. When we imagine the apocalypse, we imagine some great cataclysmic event. Gargantuan natural disasters, widespread death, panic, and violence, governments fall apart, and soon it's every man for himself. And even though this would be objectively terrible if it were to happen, we love imagining stuff like it, right? And sure, the details change depending on who's telling the story or what kind of disaster rhetoric is currently in vogue, but we tell these kinds of stories all the time. But why? Dr. Mary Manjikan argues that apocalyptic literature offers us a way of thinking beyond our own situatedness. Through imagining the death of the state, we are freed from our bodily attachment to it. We, the survivors, are able to look upon the state as a body, and to see not only where it is now, but the sum total of its life. And this makes sense, because, you see, the word apocalypse actually comes from the ancient Greek word for revealing or uncovering, which you will learn over and over and over and over if you read literally any piece of writing about the apocalypse. They all say it. It's like it's a requirement at this point. It's really giving, like, starting your fifth grade book report with a dictionary definition energy. Like, what distinct vibes. So, according to Dr. Manjikan and the definition of the word apocalypse, we are using all of this apocalyptic media to reflect on our society. So, what does this reflection actually show us? When we look down at the body of the world, what do we see? Well, a lot of researchers and writers and even YouTubers who have talked about the apocalypse see something terrible. The world represented by our apocalyptic media is hyper-masculine and violent, overwhelmingly white and Western, and focused on rugged individualism. Doomsday movies always focus on how disasters affect the US, the UK, and other countries in the global north, and they follow the stories of straight, white, upper-middle-class protagonists. Prepper shows and the people who talk about them focus on the mostly white, mostly male survivalists that buy up guns and seeds and booby traps. People who are only out for themselves and obviously just want an excuse to shoot people. All that media shows a world full of people who can't wait for apocalyptic destruction. It gives a stage to our selfishness, our obsession with individualism over community, our refusal to acknowledge perspectives outside of the conventional white Western heteronormative one. You just have to watch these shows and movies and you'll see all the worst parts of our society on display. If you take all of this research at face value, then yes, our apocalyptic media shows that we're all terrible and we want the world to end because we're selfish monsters who can't see past our own biases or who just want their apocalyptic theory to be proven right. But something that's important to keep in mind is that our media isn't necessarily a perfect representation of our actual behaviors, beliefs, and societal norms. Like Richard G. Mitchell Jr. puts it in his seminal book, Dancing at Armageddon, Survivalism and Chaos in Modern Times, there is value in survivalist texts, but advertisements for products and services must not be read as destinations, only signposts. Not as evidence of survivalist interests, only of survivalist-oriented marketing. Any study of survivalism must confront the tension between sentiments and acts, words and deeds, what survivalists say or are claimed to have said, and what they do. In other words, Just because we see something represented in our media, whether it's our disaster movies or our prepper shows or advertisements on the internet, that's not always actually representative of reality. Actions speak louder than words, and especially when it comes to reality television, even actions can be contrived for entertainment. So even if those writers' interpretations aren't 100% wrong, it's still important to consider what else we might be misinterpreting about the end of the world and our apocalyptic tendencies. And when I started digging into what we actually know about the end of the world, as a historical cultural artifact, as a media trope, and as a nebulous but terrifying cataclysmic event, a lot of that information contradicts many of our assumptions and beliefs about the apocalypse. We clearly have this obsession, we have all of these cultural feelings, but what's less clear is why we have them and what they really say about us. So, in order to get to the root of why we want the world to end, we first need to dispel some common myths, like, but Zoe! So what if we want the world to end? This isn't anything unique. All cultures have apocalypse myths. We've always been obsessed with the end of the world. Most cultures around the world have what appears to be an apocalypse myth. We have the oft-misinterpreted Mayan calendar that gave us the whole 2012 thing. We have the Norse event of Ragnarok, a huge final battle in which even gods will be killed, bringing about the end of the world. And of course, there's the Christian story in the book of Revelation, which envisions a final judgment of all humanity, and life as we know it ends, existing instead as heaven on earth. And all of these stories look like true apocalypses, and at least one of them is. But this view of apocalypses as single cataclysmic events, events from which there is no return, is actually a pretty modern invention. Many ancient cultures didn't so much believe in the idea of one big apocalypse that would end the world once and for all, but instead believed in cycles. They believed that the world went through phases, some of which are destructive, but it always eventually circled back around. The Mayan calendar didn't predict the end of the world, just a shift from one part of the cycle to another. Ragnarok would cause the deaths of several gods and see the entire earth flooded, but it would eventually dry up, and the surviving gods and humans would come back together and repopulate. Or consider the Hindu yugas, the different phases or ages that the world goes through every 432,000 years. Several Native American cultures have also had this kind of cyclical view of things. Sure, the world might end, but you'll have somewhere new to go, some new kind of earth to inhabit. So it's less about endings and more about change. In many traditional Native American myths, humanity has to physically relocate and adapt their lifestyles to meet whatever new kind of world awaits them on the other side of the cycle. The reason why many older cultures held these beliefs and most contemporary people don't is because of a fundamental difference in how we understand time. As Matthew Barrett Gross and Mel Gillis explain in their book, The Last Myth, for nearly all of human history, humanity has held a circular view of time, the understanding that the universe goes through periods of birth, renewal, decay, and death, periods that repeat endlessly, just as the seasons and diurnal cycles repeat themselves endlessly. This is due partially to the fact that we often based our understanding of the world on nature, and nature is full of cycles, but it's also partially because many traditional societies conceived of themselves through myth. They saw myth as an explanation of how the world came to be and why it functions the way it does. And importantly, they saw their own lives as reenactments of myths. Whatever humans did was simply a replication, a ritual reenactment of what the gods had done or were doing. When someone planted a crop, he or she was simply replicating the moment when the gods themselves had first planted crops in the story of creation. People conceived of themselves and their world through myth, and myths are often focused on creation, not destruction. They explain how things came to be, not how they will end. They tell the stories of beginnings, not endings. Even when there were endings, those endings were usually just in service of new beginnings. The world only ends so it can begin again anew. In a culture where it was important to understand and follow the teachings of those myths, there was often little regard for endings. People just didn't really waste time worrying about a final, cataclysmic, ultimate end from which no new beginning would arise. Because time just didn't work that way for them. That other type of thinking, that very linear view of time with one beginning and one ending, didn't really come about until the birth of the Abrahamic religions. Now, I am not going to get into the entire history of Judaism or Christianity because A, I am not an expert in Judaism or a Bible scholar, and B, a deep dive history detour would probably take way too long, and this script is already 4,000 words longer than I want it to be. Anyway, suffice it to say, for a lot of reasons, Judaism was really the first religion to have a sense of a linear view of time. They believed that God was there at the world's beginning, and that he promised them some kind of ending. A good ending, where life on Earth would eventually reach some kind of utopia in a new Garden of Eden, but a real ending nonetheless. Jewish people weren't the only ones to start shifting toward a linear view, but they were the ones that went on to have some of the biggest impact on world history, so that's what we're going to focus on. Anyway, early Judaism had the seeds of linear time, and then when Christianity popped up, it really cemented those beliefs, and even made the ending feel much more imminent. Jesus laid out specific details of what events would indicate that the end times were on their way, and he often emphasized that they could happen at any moment. At one point, he even implied that the rapture would occur before the current generation passed away. A few years after Jesus' death, the Apostle Paul reiterated many of Jesus' talking points, and even went so far as to tell early Christians that they shouldn't bother getting married because the end is nigh. Now, obviously, the end didn't arrive, but that linear apocalyptic view of things stuck, and Christianity wound up spreading around the world because, you know, history happened. Christianity went from Rome to England, and then from England to everywhere else. Conquest, crusades, colonialism. Over the course of 2,000 years, Christianity became the dominant religion of the West, and with it came that linear view of time. And when something is linear, it requires a beginning point and an end point. On one hand, we have religious creation stories and the Big Bang, and on the other end, we have rapture, Ragnarok, and robot takeovers. Most ancient cultures saw the world much differently than we do now, but we have a tendency to map our current ways of thinking onto older cultures. We see an old calendar carved into stone, and because we see beginnings and endings, we assume that the calendar was intentionally created to have a beginning and ending too. But we're wrong to think that way. But Zoe! Whether or not we've always held apocalyptic beliefs is beside the point. What really matters is all the crazy preppers who are obsessed with the end of the world right now. Let's talk about preppers. We have this image of preppers and survivalists before them from popular media, where there are all these rugged individualists who are really into guns and gadgets. They're probably middle-aged white guys, they probably lean conservative, to put it lightly, and they dream of the day that the government collapses and they're free to do whatever they want, like shoot anyone they see and booby-trap their entire house and not have to pay taxes. But is that who they really are? A lot of writers think that this portrayal is accurate. According to Casey Ryan Kelly in his article, The Manpocalypse: Doomsday Preppers and the Rituals of Apocalyptic Manhood, I love that title so much, actually, unironically. In this emerging brand of reality programming, predominantly white men are provided a theatrical space to perform their feelings of rage and victimhood, deliver monologues about the collapse of civilization, model their armaments, rehearse paramilitary battles with post-apocalyptic marauders, and exhibit their masculine know-how. Through repeated displays of manly preparedness rituals in machine shops, gun ranges, and wilderness, Doomsday Preppers constructs hegemonic masculinity as a set of survival tools, an antidote for a crumbling and emasculated society. So not only are preppers mostly angry white men, but these angry white men are actively dangerous. But this article's arguments, along with a lot of the other things that you'll often read about preppers and survivalists, are coming from reality TV and accounts of extremists who happen to be into survivalism. And as I mentioned earlier, basing your beliefs about something on media about that thing is bound to be flawed. As Michael F. Mills puts it, a lack of empirical engagement with prepping's politics has not prevented some authors from speculatively linking this movement to extremism. Many authors' claims rely, problematically, on an analysis of reality television documentaries on prepping. Lacking direct engagement with any preppers whatsoever, they thus fail to offer a reliable and robust understanding of this movement's political reality, influences, or significance. In other words, Instead of looking at how people act on Doomsday Preppers and then inferring their beliefs based on those performances, why not just talk to them? Well, that's what Richard G. Mitchell Jr. did for his book Dancing at Armageddon, an ethnography of survivalists conducted over several years through interviews and conventions and camping trips. Mitchell Jr. actually talked to survivalists, and he made several important findings that dispute many conventional beliefs about prepping culture. One of the things he found was that prepping isn't as patriarchal as we tend to believe. In many cases, Mitchell Jr. found, women were the ones doing the real work during the survivalist retreats he attended for his research. The women did the work that was practical, rational, effective, and necessary. And when men tried to handle planning tasks, they ended up drifting into confusion or tedium or falling apart. Contemporary researchers have found that many prepper accounts on internet forums and social media are also from women. Now, there are definitely further questions worth asking about this, for instance, about whether they're seeing more women preppers on the internet because particular platforms have more women on them in general, but at least at a glance, prepping isn't just a man's world. Mitchell Jr. also found that survivalists didn't actually talk politics as much as we tend to believe either. During their outings and get-togethers, they'd mostly just talk about gear, gadgets, and various pieces of advice they'd found recently. Contemporary researchers have also found that prepping isn't inherently right-wing today either. In recent years, there has been an increase in left-leaning preppers, especially as it relates to climate anxiety. But the most important mischaracterization of preppers is about their goals and desires. Most of us tend to believe that they're all those angry, dangerous extremists that we see in places like Doomsday Preppers. But for the most part, from all the accounts I looked at, they nearly all conclude that preppers mostly just want to make stuff. As Mitchell Jr. covered in his ethnography, survivalist conventions were full of homemade gadgets and DIY projects, or bricolage if you're fancy, and the survivalist retreats made space for storytelling, showing off gear, and sharing advice. They're not waiting for destruction, they're engaging in creation. But crafts, DIY, and being a maker are all hobbies on their own, but these people don't call themselves crafters or makers, they call themselves preppers and survivalists. There is obviously some inherent apocalyptic bent to what they're doing, so where does that come into all this? Well, most researchers argue that preppers are into crafting, gathering, and storytelling as a way to gain agency over their lives. Because in this world, everything is easy. We have an endless assortment of products to choose from, but we don't actually have any connection to most of the stuff we consume. Even at work, many of us don't have a lot of power or agency. To quote Mitchell Jr., contemporary life encourages obscurity, makes messengers of many. Words and works pass through us, but are not marked by us. We redirect information, goods, and services. We do not create them. We ladle out the textbook content, bolt on the replacement parts, assemble the units manufactured elsewhere, dispense someone else's pills, enforce rules not of our own making on peoples not of our choosing, and repeat others' words. We do not construct culture. At best, we maintain it. Most of us feel powerless, like what we do and who we are aren't actually important in the grand scheme of things. And survivalists and preppers feel that too. And while we all have different ways of remedying this, like for instance, if you feel like your voice isn't being heard at work, maybe you become a YouTuber. The way preppers remedy it is through making their own resistance, through imagining a world where things aren't as easy, where everyday people do have a hand in shaping culture, where their handiness skills are valued by more than just a few niche hobbyists, through conjuring an apocalypse where they matter. So, when it comes down to it, most preppers really just want to feel in control of their lives. They want agency. They want to feel like what they do matters. And isn't that something a lot of us can relate to? Now, it is true that this mindset also often comes with a desire to protect their family and their property, and they often consider violence a good way to do that. But that actually comes from another myth. But Zoe! It's all well and good that these guys are finding ways to feel special, but they're still gonna have to defend themselves in the apocalypse. There's gonna be violence and looting and roving bands of marauders, and when everything falls apart, the facade of civilization disappears and people become animals. It's just human nature. Part of the reason preppers and survivalists care so much about guns is because they've held onto the idea that when the world ends, people are going to dissolve into a panicky, violent mess. It's the same reason billionaires are building bunkers to keep themselves safe and hoard resources. Because when shit hits the fan, people become selfish, dangerous animals. When disaster strikes, people fall apart. People are selfish and cruel and wild, and society is the only thing holding us together, so if society collapses, people revert back to their animalistic nature. But let's talk about why this is false. Because not only is it wrong, it is fundamentally, overwhelmingly, amazingly wrong. One of the most widely used tropes in disaster fiction is the scene of people panicking. People shoving, trampling, screaming, making sure they're the first people through the door of the burning building, the first people on the escape pod away from danger, the first people to get the vaccine to save them from the zombie virus. But this doesn't have hardly any basis in reality. According to sociologist Lee Clark, panic is actually exceedingly rare in disaster situations. Part of the reason for this is because what we imagine when we think of panic isn't actually panic. True panic is when fear or anxiety lead to irrational, unreasonable behaviors and chaos. But, and this is the other reason that panic is so rare, in most disaster situations in reality, people don't actually do those irrational, unreasonable things. Sure, when we imagine panic, we usually picture scenes from movies and TV shows where people act wild and selfish, but in real life, this just doesn't happen. As Lee Clark puts it, we have nearly 50 years of evidence on panic, and the conclusion is clear. People rarely panic, at least in the usual sense the word is used. Even when people feel excessive fear, they usually avoid injudicious efforts and chaos. In particular, they are unlikely to cause harm to others as they reach for safety and may even put their own lives at risk to help others. It is not unusual to read quotes from survivors of catastrophes in which people interpret the behaviors of others, or even themselves, in terms of panic. What they're usually reporting, though, are feelings of fear, not panic-stricken behavior. For instance, writer Rebecca Solnit conducted interviews with survivors of 9/11 and found that many people in the towers when the plane struck not only didn't panic, but were actively calm and helpful. Throughout the chapter about 9/11 in her book, A Paradise Built in Hell, she relays story after story after story from survivors describing how helpful and kind people were during those terrifying minutes. As workers evacuated, they simply walked in an orderly fashion down the steps, and even let injured and disabled people by them since they had to be carried down. Most people didn't start running until they'd reached the ground floor and the firefighters told them to run. There are dozens of examples in this book of people in different cultures, different situations, of different ages and backgrounds, all experiencing disasters and just not panicking. Long story short, truly panicked behavior is exceptionally rare. Sometimes stuff looks or feels like panic and is therefore often reported to be panic, but more often than not, it just isn't. But sure, we might not panic when disaster strikes, but what about afterwards when there's no more society to keep us in check? That's when we become dangerous and selfish, right? Just like with the panic stuff, most of what we believe about the innate badness of people comes from movies and news. Most zombie apocalypse media makes sure to hammer home that people are the real monsters. And the news loves to report on how people in disaster-stricken areas turn to murder and crime when shit hits the fan. Hell, just look at the infamous Stanford prison experiment. When rules go out the window, when all bets are off, people are terrible to each other. But, fortunately for us, the people are the real monsters rhetoric just doesn't hold up under scrutiny. For instance, take the aftermath of Hurricane Katrina. The way it was reported at the time, you'd think that the entire city of New Orleans had devolved into a lawless death trap. But, to bring back Rebecca Solnit's A Paradise Built in Hell, the reality was that there was more mutual aid and far less social Darwinism inside the convention center and the Superdome than the media reported and the authorities imagined. As a September 26, 2005 Newhouse News Service story went on to conclude, the vast majority of reported atrocities committed by evacuees, mass murders, rapes, and beatings, have turned out to be false, or at least unsupported by any evidence, according to key military, law enforcement, medical, and civilian officials in positions to know. People weren't actually monsters. The news just said they were. Even the Stanford prison experiment wasn't as bad as you think it was. As Rutger Bregman explains in Humankind, A Hopeful History, the Stanford prison experiment was fundamentally flawed from the outset, since Zimbardo, the guy who ran the study, actually coached some of the participants on how to act. He told them to take away the prisoner's individuality, to create in them a sense of powerlessness. Things didn't go badly because of some innate badness in humans. It went badly because the researcher wanted it to. Some other researchers, a few decades later, actually wanted to try to recreate it on reality TV without coaching the participants, and it was amazing. Like, listen to this. On day two, a guard suggested sharing the guard's food with the prisoners to boost morale. On day five, one of the prisoners proposed setting up a democracy. On day six, some prisoners escaped from their cells. They headed over to the guard's canteen to enjoy a smoke, where the guards soon came to join them. On day seven, the group voted in favor of creating a commune. In this book, Bregman also debunks the real-life Lord of the Flies experiments. They went about as well as the reality TV prison experiment, and it only devolved into conflict when the researchers forced it to. And he debunks the bystander effect. People do usually help each other unless they have an actual good reason to do otherwise, including the case of Kitty Genovese. It was the police that failed her, not her neighbors. Also, something that I think is important to add, Kitty didn't die alone. A neighbor was able to find one of her friends, and she found her before she passed away. Not soon enough to save her, but enough that she wasn't alone at the end. In a nutshell, it's the same thing that I've been saying throughout this whole section. People are good and helpful. Media, pop culture, and cynicism have just convinced us that they aren't. But they are, and they always have been. There are numerous examples of archaeologists finding the remains of mature adult humans that show signs of physical disabilities, which implies that even in our caveman days, the days when it would make most sense to be selfish because it was a brutal dog-eat-dog world, we took care of each other. We helped those who could not help themselves. And that's exactly what we're seeing in disasters, too. When terrible things happen, under the worst conditions where you would expect the most panicky, selfish behavior, people do good things. And that's not to say that we should want disasters to happen just because they bring out goodness in people. On the contrary, Betsy Hartman writes in her book The America Syndrome, disasters can awaken positive economic and political transformation. That doesn't mean we should hope for more disasters, but it does provide one less reason to lie awake at night worrying about impending catastrophes. Or, to quote Rebecca Solnit, it's simply that disaster sometimes knocks down institutions and structures and suspends private life, leaving a broader view of what lies beyond. The task before us is to recognize the possibilities visible through that gateway and endeavor to bring them into the realm of the everyday. This sounds amazing. Change the world so that we can be these great, altruistic, helpful people all the time, right? Not if you're one of the people invested in the world staying how it is, it doesn't. This is part of why this myth persists, because powerful people desperately want it to be true. As Rutger Bregman says in Humankind, for the powerful, a hopeful view of human nature is downright threatening, subversive, seditious. It implies that we're not selfish beasts that need to be reined in, restrained, and regulated. It implies we need a different kind of leadership. This idea that people are good and kind and caring is actively dangerous to the people whose livelihoods rely on the myths of panic and selfishness. So, during disasters, those in positions of power tend to make decisions that reinforce their position, to perpetuate the hierarchy of power. This is how we end up with billionaires building bunkers where they plan to continue employing low-wage workers to cook and clean for them, even after the world ends. And how we get things like the Wall Street Journal Guide to Investing in the Apocalypse, which teaches people how to make money during disasters using event-based investing, which is the most ghoulish thing I have ever heard of. But the selfishness and fear of elites often has dire consequences for the rest of us. This is what disaster sociologist Kathleen Tierney refers to as elite panic, a term actually coined by our old friend Lee Clark and his partner Karen Chess. Tierney describes elite panic as comprised of fear of social disorder, fear of poor, minorities, and immigrants, obsession with looting and property crime, willingness to resort to deadly force, and actions taken on the basis of rumor. Exactly the kinds of things that we see happen during disasters. Think of the rhetoric used during the aftermath of Hurricane Katrina, or during any police brutality protests. Law and order are gone, and people are out there roaming the streets, looting stores, and lighting fires. Someone needs to go down there and put those people back in their place. But the fear of all this so-called violence that usually isn't even happening in the first place leads to disaster response backfiring, just making things worse. Elite panic is both very real and very dangerous. The people who are actually panicking in disasters happen to be the people who have the money and the power to make rash decisions based on that panic. As Lee Clark and Karen Chess put it, because the positions they occupy command the power to move resources, elite panic is more consequential than public panic. Yet it's rarely, if ever, actually called panic. When leaders of government agencies and corporations under stress brush aside facts, neglect or forget their training, and neglect standard practice, such things are never called panic. But that may be a mistake. For it may be that the conventional categories smuggle into analysis vocabularies of motive that misdirect our attention, obscuring issues of responsibility and the power to act. In other words, when we think of panic, we think of public panic, not elite panic. But public panic isn't what causes problems during disasters. Elite panic is. By confusing the two, we blame so-called violent human nature for failures in disaster responses, instead of blaming the actions of the actual individuals calling the shots. And so it becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy. People in power are afraid of us, so they feed on rumors and violence, which puts people on edge, making us afraid of each other. And then they send in cops and the National Guard to keep us in line, and then... it's never good.
Sonnet wrote that the first rat to infect a disaster is rumor, and during Katrina, the destructive consequences of this became painfully evident. Stories of violent crimes and savagery spread like wildfire, thereby turning people in need into people to be afraid of, people to be rescued into people to be kept away. Official rescue operations became heavily stifled, sometimes even replaced with active hostility as military forces were being deployed not to take care of victims, but to enforce law and order against an imagined enemy.
They were going to put armed police there, and they were going to turn you back at gunpoint.
This was Jefferson Parish police lined up with shotguns, would not let us cross that bridge, made us go back.
Salvation turned to damnation, and the disaster caused by nature turned into an even greater one of our own doing.
This myth sits at the core of the last two myths we looked at. But if this myth is wrong, then those other ones are wrong too. And if they're all wrong, if violence and selfishness aren't our default settings when disasters strike, then there must be something else. So, when you look at it all laid out like this, an interesting pattern starts to take shape. All of these myths seem to come from the same thing, right? Our linear sense of time and the tendency to map our current ways of thinking onto ancient cultures come from colonialism. Our feelings of alienation and lack of control over our own lives come from our economic systems. Our mistrust and skepticism for others come from sensationalist media and the rhetoric of those in power. They all come from the top down. They come from the structures around us, not from inside us. So, what does that say about us? Why are we obsessed with the apocalypse? Do we really want the world to end? If so, why? Well, we are definitely obsessed with the end of the world, but it's not because of some innate desire for destruction or because we've always been this way. We're not all violent animals inside. In fact, we actually tend to want to help other people when shit hits the fan. So where does this obsession come from? Well, that's where preppers come in. While we might not all stockpile canned goods and water purifiers and weapons, most of us do still feel the alienation and powerlessness that lead preppers to do those things. Our obsession with the end of the world comes from a lack of agency over our lives, a feeling that something isn't right, a feeling that things should be different. We imagine the end of the world because through it, we get to imagine what our lives could be like if we didn't have these structures holding us down. If we didn't have colonialism or this current economic system or 24-hour news cycles or politicians, we secretly want the world to end because the end of the world gives us a blank slate upon which we are free to imagine something new. So, what do we do about this? It's all well and good to imagine the end of the world, but right now it's just imagination. And before anyone puts words in my mouth, I am not saying that we should try to end the world. Like I covered in the human nature section, just because disasters illuminate our goodness, that doesn't mean that we should wish for disasters. We have all these stories, all this imagination, all this pent-up frustration with how things are, but what do we do with it? That depends on one final myth we need to dispel. We tend to think of the apocalypse as a single cataclysmic event that ends the world in a series of moments. It's a single meteor hitting the Earth. It's a chain reaction of nuclear bombs one after the other. It's a solar flare that fries every piece of electronic equipment across the entire globe. And our media and our news feeds perpetuate this belief. Everything is apocalyptic nowadays. Everything is an existential threat. Every news story becomes a monster that could destroy the world. So you just have to keep watching to stay informed. Because if you don't, you'll be the first to fall victim to whatever the danger of the week is. And this has some pretty bad consequences. When our media suggests that terrorism, bird flu, global warming, and asteroids are all equally probable, even when they most definitely are not, it leads us to believe that our existential threats come exclusively from events that are beyond our control and that await us in the future. Despite the media's best efforts to conflate them with improbable scenarios, the existential challenges that we must confront in the 21st century don't fall into the apocalyptic storyline of future cataclysmic events that are beyond our control, because they aren't truly events, but rather are trends. Whether or not we will be able to control them hinges on our understanding that the moment of revelation doesn't lie before us in some indeterminate future. It is already here. So, in a nutshell, the world probably isn't going to end in a single big event. It's probably going to be a trend, some slow, barely perceptible disaster. But because of Hollywood and the 24-hour news cycle that prey on spectacle and fear, we've been led to believe that it's going to be the opposite. And because of this, we tend to ignore the actual issues happening around us. Because climate change doesn't look like the disasters in the movie 2012, we don't see it as a threat. But the truth is, we will be the proverbial frogs being slowly boiled alive. As Hungarian filmmaker Bela Tarr puts it, the apocalypse is a huge event, but reality is not like that. In my film, the end of the world is very silent, very weak. So the end of the world comes as I see it coming in real life, slowly and quietly. Death is always the most terrible scene, and the most terrible thing is that it looks like nothing happened. This trend, not event thing comes with good news and bad news. The good news is that a slow apocalypse means we have time to stop the world from ending. The bad news is that we have time to stop the world from ending. With the power to prevent the end of the world comes the responsibility to prevent the end of the world. And no one likes responsibility. It is so much easier to fantasize about who we could be when the world ends and just let it happen, right? But this is why our obsession with the apocalypse can be so dangerous, because it shows us a way out of where we are now, and most of us can agree that where we are now isn't great, but it tells us that we can get there by doing nothing. If the world ends in an event, we don't have to change. Either the world changes for us, or we all die and don't have to worry about it anymore. But if it's a trend, the world won't change for us. We'll have to make change happen. There is some more good news, though, because all those other myths I covered earlier come together to give us a clear way forward. If we haven't always focused on a final end to the world, then that means that we're free to think cyclically rather than linearly. If survivalists and preppers aren't actually violent weirdos, then we don't have to be afraid of them. We can join them in their pursuit of real meaning and purpose. If people aren't evil, then we can stop being so suspicious of our fellow humans. We can start to trust again, to see ourselves as a group rather than as individuals in a never-ending fight for resources. But that's all really vague and abstract, right? So how do we actually do those things? Through all the sources I read for this video, I found three things, three simple but powerful ideas that we can all learn to cultivate if we want to change the world. Okay, so this first one is a little bit new agey, but bear with me. In her book, Imaginable, Jane McGonigal lays out a step-by-step guide for how to manifest the future you want simply by imagining it through what is called episodic future thinking. And again, I know this sounds like weird hippie shit, but give me a second. So episodic future thinking is an exercise where you basically simulate the future in your mind. You imagine some future scenario in as much specific detail as possible, and this is actually shown to help people not only feel more optimistic about the future, but it also increases motivation and makes people more likely to adopt behaviors that have long-term benefits. Simply by imagining the specific concrete details of what your morning routine might be at 9:45 a.m. and a Tuesday in April of 2030, literally playing that out in your brain moment by moment, including all the specific sounds and smells and movements, you can make yourself more hopeful for the future. So, how can we use this to change our world? Well, if clear, detailed, specific mental visions can help us change ourselves, we can use them to change stuff outside of us. There are several exercises laid out in this book, but I'll just cover one here. 100 ways anything can be different. In this game, you take an object or a concept, like video games, and then you write down 100 true, or mostly generally true, statements about your topic. This game is best played as a group. Good luck thinking up 100 facts about anything on your own. So we might have, video games are popular with young people, and there are many different kinds of video games. Then you rewrite each statement so that in 10 years, the opposite will be true. In 10 years, video games will be popular with old people. In 10 years, there will be only a few different kinds of video games. The rest of this exercise is you and your group coming up with ways that these sometimes nonsensical statements make sense. You have to construct a world where these statements are true, and this is often easier said than done. Sure, it makes sense that in 10 years, video games will be popular with old people. The average age of gamers is increasing every year since the generation that first grew up with games is aging. But what about the other one? My brain first went to some kind of government regulation that censored several different kinds of games, any first-person shooters or fighting games, for instance. But part of this exercise is about really stretching your brain and not discounting any idea, as wild as it seems. The way McGonigal phrases it is that all ideas should be ridiculous at first. So maybe there's some kind of, like, internet crash or disaster or industrial espionage that somehow breaks every online game distributor, and suddenly all your games from Steam or Xbox Live or the Epic Game Store are just gone. The only games still playable are ones with physical editions. Now, this was a purposefully silly example, but you can do this exercise with just about anything and come up with justifications that are as simple as people get older, or as utopian as we develop an entire new economic system, or there just is enough food to go around. The point is to be as detailed as possible with your responses and to not discount any answer, even if it seems unrealistic or absurd. It's only by thinking about the future in these concrete terms that we can actually start to see a path from A to B. It's only by breaking down otherwise ridiculous ideas into the realistic steps that could get us there that we can imagine a way to change things. As Choctaw writer Stephen Charleston puts it in his book, We Survived the End of the World, we are limited, finite, fallible people who think we have very little power when it comes to confronting an apocalypse. Our resignation is not so much giving up as it is never imagining otherwise. The only way to start making changes is by imagining that we can. Apocalyptic thinking isn't the only way to conceive of the world. There is an alternative, as distant as it feels sometimes. We must have the courage to imagine something outside of our linear apocalyptic view, to imagine a more cyclical, interconnected view of the world. It's more than just vague notions of utopia. It's detailed visions of specific situations that can be reverse engineered in order to bring them to fruition. We can imagine new ways of running things, new ways of working together, new ways of doing anything. We just have to imagine it. Next is agency. Now, I know that it's easy to feel powerless. It is easy to look at our huge, globalized, interconnected world and feel like your voice doesn't matter. Our whole system is built on individualism, not community. On more and bigger and me, me, me. And now, even the act of prepping, something that was and in some ways still is about taking control back from this disconnected consumerist world, has been taken over and commercialized by the very thing it was made to get away from. Disaster preparedness guides tell you how you can keep living your individualist consumerist life even in the post-apocalypse. This is by design. They want us to feel like we're alone, just us and our guns against the world. They want us to feel disconnected and powerless because then we're easier to govern. It's easy to manipulate people who don't know their worth. Your opponents would love you to believe that it's hopeless, says Rebecca Solnit, that you have no power, that there's no reason to act, that you can't win. Hope is a gift you don't have to surrender, a power you don't have to throw away. So be hopeful. Know your worth, seize agency. But again, with great power comes great responsibility. Having agency means you have the responsibility to do something with it. To be able to change our world, we first have to acknowledge that the world we have needs changing, that it's just not sustainable. We've simply lost touch with not just the Earth and our relationship to it, but with reality itself. As Douglas Rushkoff argues, we have this tendency to objectify things and decontextualize them from the systems of which they are a part. We think of an orange as a unit of food or a product from the grocery store rather than the fruiting of a particular tree during a particular season. And so we now expect to be able to eat it anywhere and anytime we choose, disregarding what this requires of the topsoil, the highway system, or our bodies to digest it out of season or divorced from its environment. Just because our current systems try to convince you that all resources are always available and that growth is and will always be endless, that doesn't mean it's true. Now, I'm not saying that everyone watching this has to immediately go vegan and switch to only using public transportation. Stuff like climate change, for instance, cannot be fixed through individual actions. But that doesn't mean that any action you take is meaningless. There is stuff you can do on an individual level to help bring about changes. One of the big first steps is to reflect on your own actions and lifestyle. Think about your relationship to the earth. Do you know where your produce comes from? Do you know where your town or city's electricity and water are sourced from? You can also start to get involved more in your local community. Sometimes this means educating yourself on local politics, sometimes it means volunteering at soup kitchens or local shelters. Sometimes it means attending school board meetings. It means getting involved, making your presence felt. If you want some clear, concrete steps for what you can do right now, I suggest checking out the Live Like the World is Dying podcast, any and all of the amazing work on Androism's YouTube channel, and this incredible video, A Practical Guide to Systemic Change, from the genuinely phenomenal Dr. Fatima.
Editing Zoe here to say that, especially in light of recent events, I want to emphasize something. If a system is fundamentally flawed, you cannot use its methods to fix its problems. You either have to use different methods to fix the system, or just get a new system. You cannot fix a broken system from within. We need to rely on people, not on systems.
And I know that a lot of my suggestions sound like too little too late, or they sound like too much too soon, or they simply sound unrealistic, but that's also what countless societies and cultures thought right before they collapsed. History shows that when faced with such metaphysical crises, cultures either adapt their worldview to the new reality, or the society collapses. When the solutions required to solve a crisis are in opposition to a cultural worldview, the culture finds itself headed for disaster. Even as the threat intensifies, worldview defense suggests that we'll cling more tightly to the very worldview that is causing us harm. The outcome of such situations is purely binary. Cultures either collapse when their worldview fails to adapt, or alternately, the culture adapts, the world continues, and a new worldview evolves to reflect the actual circumstances facing the society. There is no other way out. But the good news is that we can change. There is ample food, water, and energy for everyone, says Rushkov. There's just not enough to satisfy economic models that depend on infinite exponential growth. We can bring about the future we want to see. We just have to be brave enough to see the systems that have to change and then change them. Remember, preppers do what they do because they want to feel useful. They want to feel like they have some real connection to the world, some power to shape their own lives, free from the current systems we've built. And this is true for all of us. It's why we all feel this obsession with the end of the world, why we all kind of secretly want it to end. Because we feel like what we're doing now either doesn't matter or isn't as useful or fulfilling as it could be. But we don't have to wait for the world to end to do fulfilling things that matter. We can make that imagined better world a reality here, now. Revolutionary change does not come as one cataclysmic moment. Beware of such moments. But as an endless succession of surprises, moving zigzag toward a more decent society. We don't have to engage in grand, heroic acts to participate in the process of change. Small acts, when multiplied by millions of people, can transform the world. The future is an infinite succession of presents. And to live now as we think human beings should live, in defiance of all that is bad around us, is itself a marvelous victory. And finally, trust. To quote Stephen Charleston, an apocalypse may very well bring us together to meet an imminent danger, but once that apocalypse has receded, it will not be strong enough to keep us together. Something greater than fear is needed to build community. We can imagine anything we want. We can stand up for ourselves and take our lives into our own hands, but we cannot accomplish anything alone. And to build a community, we need to trust one another. It is so easy to talk about community, but to actually do it, to make connections with people and work together and have friends and exist in public, that sounds terrifying and mentally exhausting. Community building is scary. I struggle with it a lot myself. I believe in the goodness of people, but I still find it hard to build community and come together to make changes in the world. It's just easier to believe that stuff sucks, and people are mean, and the world is cruel. As Rutger Bregman puts it at the end of his book, cynicism is just another word for laziness. It's an excuse not to take responsibility. Because if you believe most people are rotten, you don't need to get worked up about injustice. The world is going to hell either way. It really is so easy to hide away from other people, to avoid putting yourself out there, to just build a shell around yourself. If you don't take any chances, if you don't let yourself be vulnerable, then nothing can hurt you. But community means different things to different people. It doesn't have to mean going to a town hall meeting or putting up a Steven Crowder-style change my mind table at a public park. Sometimes it means going to free RPG nights at your local game store. Sometimes it means going to your public library and asking the librarian what kind of book they recommend. Sometimes it means just being a human in a public space, physically or virtually. I really recommend Ponderful's Autism, Anxiety, and Misanthropy and Babila's Why Are You So Anti-Human for more on this. I found their videos personally really helpful. Remember, people aren't the panicky, selfish animals that movies and conventional wisdom would have us believe. People are helpful, they're selfless, and they even often put themselves in harm's way just to help others. People are good. And if people are good, we can start to move past the barriers we've built. We can start to listen to each other in good faith. We can start to have conversations and share our perspectives. We can make room at our tables for everyone. It's going to take a long time, and it's not going to be easy, but we can do it together. The world is scary and sad and unfair a lot of the time, and that might make us want to just start over from scratch. It's been a good run, but we screwed it up in the end. Time to pack up and head home. But just because it's bad sometimes, that doesn't mean it's not worth saving. And even if we can't save it, we can at least savor it. Life is hard, and it sucks that we have to be active participants in existence, but isn't it wild that we exist at all? Isn't it amazing that we have mass and take up space and that we live with billions of other motes of existence on a planet that has mountains and trees and oceans bigger than we can even wrap our brains around? Isn't there something magical about that? Existence is hard, but it's worth it every time. I want to end by reading you a poem from Tumblr user Inkskinned. Actually, life is beautiful, because the sound I make while trying to breathe around hot food sounds like my dog trying to eat an apple. When I yawn, my cat tries to put his face in my mouth like a little dentist man, and when he yawns, I put my finger in his obligate carnivore trap zone, and we both know he will not hurt me. When I do not fold my clothes, they do not hold it against me. I am demonstrably sad and lonely and full of fear. But there are other people who will hold my hand, who will point out the hawk overhead, who will give you that look in a public place. The other day at a coffee shop, a child said, "Look, it's snowing," so all of us strangers went to look out the window. It wasn't the first snow, and it won't be the last, but wasn't it lovely like that? How wonderful to live in a world where birds and frogs both say beep. How wonderful to have an ocean of beautiful sharks with their dinosaur teeth. How wonderful the moon and her changing face. How wonderful the bees and their dancing to communicate. How wonderful shrimp and their forbidden layers of vision. How wonderful you and what you will give to the world. The way we love things enough to spend entire blogs devoted to them. How people will let me explain my Pokemon team to them. How we will both jump at the scare in the movie. How we laugh so loudly how it feels to give someone your baking. How wonderful to be alive. I'm sorry for forgetting. This is the process of getting better. With wonderful people and wonderful strangers and wonderful friends. I am getting better. Slowly. Thank you, whoever you are. In some way, you've been wonderful and left a wonderful place in the world to ripple out to me. In some small way, isn't it beautiful? I promise you've been helping. Thank you for watching until the end. This was a huge labor of love for me, so I'd really appreciate it if you liked the video and subscribed to the channel. I have so many people to thank for this video. First of all, Nick and all the other folks from the Human Restoration Project, they approached me about doing an ad for their upcoming conference. And as soon as I heard that the theme was breaking the doom loop, I knew that this was like the perfect opportunity to finally do the big apocalypse video that I've been wanting to do for like literally years. So again, if you are interested in attending the conference, I have links in the description, or you can go to humanrestorationproject.org/conference, I believe is the URL, and use code ZOEB to get $25 off and to also help support the channel. I also wanna give a huge thanks to Sarah at the University of Nebraska Press and Jana at Broadleaf Publishing for sending me advance review copies of Who Would You Kill to Save the World by Claire Colebrook and We Survived the End of the World by Stephen Charleston, respectively. Both of those books were incredibly helpful when writing this video, and I especially loved We Survived the End of the World, and I definitely recommend picking that up if you were into a lot of the things that I brought up near the end of the video, because a lot of that was just based on his book, and it's a really moving book, like full of amazing advice for how we can learn from Indigenous folks about what we can do when it feels like the world is ending. So definitely recommend those. And last but not least, the biggest of thanks to my patrons and channel members, especially A Tasty Snack, Adam, Hugh Sophia, Jaded Flames, Justin Lowry, Nicholas Welch, Paige Hansen, and Robert Bradford. Thank you all so very much. You can help to directly support my work through joining my Patreon or becoming a channel member, and you will get early access to videos and your name in the credits and have the chance to have me dedicate one of my end-of-video poems to you. So if any of that sounds interesting, you can go ahead and check out patreon.com/Zoe_B or click the little join button that is down there below this video, probably over here. finally, today's patron poem of the video for Gender Druid is an ode to the last tomato on the counter. I hope she does not consider her fate, sitting there beside the knife block, or fear the salt and the heat. I hope she revels in the loose skin her sisters never got to have, her flesh softened by age. I hope she is given a death worthy of the life she lived, for a meal I won't remember. And until next time, stay safe, stay warm, and I will see y'all again soon, I hope. Bye, folks. Gosh, I hope this one wasn't a downer. I feel like even the poem I wrote was a downer, and I didn't mean it to be. I really hope that this isn't as sad as I worry it is. Let me know in the comments. You can comment whether I have made it worse. Okay.